We're still gonna have a frog test. Frog fall test. Okay, so we're still continuing with amphibians. We've talked about Sicilians, we've talked about the salamanders and newts, and we're gonna continue talking about the frogs and toads, because we've only talked about those a little bit and we need to get more in depth. So amphibians in general have a three-chambered heart. We learned with fish that fish have a two-chambered heart. So we're getting more advanced. The most advanced animals, which are birds and mammals and crocodiles and alligators, have a four-chambered heart. And that four-chambered heart is really important because it keeps the blood separated. So when there's a three-chambered heart, it has the blood coming into one side and then the blood leaving the other side, and then a chamber where the two bloods kind of mix together. This isn't completely efficient because the oxygen blood and the deoxygen blood that doesn't have oxygen, they get mixed up. So we're still having a mixing of the oxygen and no oxygen blood, and that makes it not super efficient, but better than a two-chamber. Since they're living on land, they need to have certain features. Strong but light bones to resist gravity. In water, you have buoyancy that helps to support the body. So many animals that live in the ocean don't even need bones at all. And you think of like the jellyfish and the octopus and things like that. They use the water around them for support. But now if we're coming out on land, we have to have some kind of structure because otherwise they'd just be a block. So they do have these bones that are lighter but strong enough to support their frame. And the skeleton is modified for movement and muscle attachment. So with fish, they had skeletons before, but the only other creature so far as evolution, that is made it to land is arthropods. And arthropods don't have any bones. So now we've got to have bones that not only provide them support, but also for some muscle attachment so they can move around. Argument for evolution is that all skeletons do have very similar structures, so they've got similar bones that we would have. Obviously, it's elongated in the salamander and it is more compacted in the frogs and toads, especially with these modified back legs that are really good for jumping. So most are going to eat insects as adults and plants and algae as juveniles. And we talked a little bit about this before, why it's important. Because, for one thing, the juveniles live in water and the adults live in a combination of water and land. But one of the main reasons is that they're not competing with each other. Because they're living in the same area, they don't want to have competition for the same food sources. So since they're eating different things, they're both able to survive okay in the same area. They do have the first true tongue. We've seen kind of some tongues in other animals, but this is the first one that's considered true. It's stretchy and sticky for catching food. It's really kind of weird because their tongues actually attach at the front of the mouth. So kind of imagine where your chin is. That's where their tongue attaches. And then their tongue flips out and grabs the bug, and then it flips back in. Whereas our tongue is attached to the back of the mouth and the front part is loose. So different attachments because different purposes. The other interesting thing about how they eat is they actually use their eyeballs to help them swallow food. Now even though the frog has little tiny teeth, they don't really chew their food, so they're swallowing these big insects whole. And the way they do that is they get it into their mouth and kind of down their throat, and then they don't really have a lot of muscles in their throat like we do. And so their eyes sink into their head and actually push the down their throat. So it's kind of cool that they swallow with their eyeballs. But very cool. So if you ever watch a frog or a salamander or something eat, as soon as they eat, they close their eyes and their eyes kind of sink down into their head.
Probably not. They would probably suffocate just because they can't get enough air.
Giving us all this false information.
It's easier to understand cold-blooded versus warm-blooded
But now that you guys are all grown up, you're ready for the truth.
Well, I'm a cold-blooded killer.
Vision is their most important sense. Also, some smell, and for frogs and toads, hearing is important too. But vision, they all have pretty large eyes that help them to see, except the ones that live in the caves. Have a nictitating membrane over their eye. The nictitating membrane is like a clear membrane that slides over the eye, so it allows them to see underwater. It protects the eye when they're in water and kind of keeps it moist. Also, the tympanic membrane. The tympanic membrane is a large round circle that is right behind the eye, and it is basically their eardrum. So they do have these big eardrums. You see them more often in frogs and toads because they're the ones that are typically making the calls to try and attract females. And usually it is the males that are calling and making that noise because they're trying to attract females to the pond.
One in the
showing the tympanic membrane. A lot of times the larger tympanic membrane is for males and the smaller ones indicate females, but the tympanic membrane is the big circle right behind the eye. You can see the nictitating membrane on the bottom picture showing that extra eyelid that comes up and covers the eye. We do see nictitating membranes on other animals. Birds are a good example. They also have a nictitating membrane. Some birds.
Do cats have one?
Cats do. But not as dramatic. It's like, it doesn't go like all the way across. All right, so that's all we're covering today.
Yeah.
I can give you more. I've got more. Your new assignment is the frog call assignment that is in Google Classroom. I've given you some websites and I've given you a list of frogs. You need to practice identifying the frog calls by going to those websites and listening to them. We will do this as a class as well, but again, you will be quizzed over this. Now, one of the best ways to remember frog calls and bird calls, so this applies to when we do bird calls as well, is to try and think of words that can put to it. Some kind of phrase or some kind of word that can be put to the noise that'll help you remember it. A lot of like the bird calls, like the chickadee, it actually makes a chickadee noise. So if you try and think of some words or phrase that it sounds like, or like for instance, the spring peeper, it sounds like two rocks that are hitting together. Okay, so try and think of something you can associate the noise with, and that'll help you with remembering the actual calls. Okay, so that's my tip. So the assignment is in Google Classroom. Go ahead and get started. Also, we have, it's not like officially parent-teacher conferences. I guess they're done a little differently here in the spring. But just keep in mind that conferences are coming up next week. And even though we're not going to be meeting with all parents, I think they're just having teachers meet with DNF students. It's still a very good time to check your grade and make sure your grade is where you want it to be. Remember, I do take late work, but you gotta actually turn it in order to get points for stuff. Okay? Questions? All right, get to work.
Can I just